So the Cardinals will meet the winner of USF and LSU in the second round on Monday night. Here are our Capital One starting lineups. First of all, for LSU, Daniel Ballard was suspended for the first 14 games of the season, still was a first-team All-SEC selection. Regine Moncrief, fourth in the conference in steals. And for USF, Courtney Williams led the American Athletic Conference in scoring. Alicia Jenkins was the 11th leading rebounder in the NCAA. I'm Bob Picozzi, along with former Big South Player of the Year Brooke Weisbrod. And Brooke, in Courtney Williams, USF has one of the most unheralded great players in the country.
She's a scorer, Bob. 20 points a game, you see, led the American Athletic Conference this year with those 20 points a game. But she's also a rebounder. She's also a playmaker. Those assists come in handy. And her mid-range game is so nice. I love it. Can't wait to see it today.
Courtney Williams loosening up. She needs just 16 points tonight to break the USF single-season scoring record. Our officials are Dee Cantner, Clark Stevens, and Catherine Lukanich. Jumping center will be Regine Moncrief for LSU, Alicia Jenkins, who can really get up in the air for USF, and the tap controlled by the Bulls. They're the number six seed, so they're the home team, literally and figuratively.
Exactly, and LSU's defense, you'll see it. They're able to take positions away, take spacing away. Very aggressive and very sound fundamentally.
Williams with the first shot of the night. And the rebound in traffic winds up on a hop to Caitlin Weber for USF. And she put it on the deck and was stripped by Sheila Boykin. On the break, Moncrief with the pull-up. Rebound tapped out of Weber's hands into the hands of Laura Marcos-Canedo. And a charge will be called on Laura Ferreira, the first foul of the night. There's her coach, Jose Fernandez, the winningest coach in USF history, has his Bulls in the NCAA tournament for the third time and the second time in the last 3 years. This is the first NCAA tournament home game in program history for the Bulls, and Danielle Ballard hits the first basket of the game.
LSU's aggressiveness has a lot to do with number 32 and what she does. They defensively, as a unit, they stay that way. But on offense, they really need a player like Danielle Ballard to set that tone. And that's a good take right there for Caitlin Weber.
Weber only averages 3 points per game. She gets on the board early. She has battled some physical issues that we'll get into as the game develops. Download the drop step by Deshaun Harden.
Deshaun Harden, a player that Nikki Caldwell really praised to us yesterday. Complimentary player. But really had to step up. When Danielle Ballard was suspended, she was a player that had to take on more responsibility from his team and become a bigger leader.
2-on-2, Moncrief with the pull-up in the lane. No need to run over people, huh?
Exactly. Now, isn't that nice? It's a short little jump shot. It goes in. You don't have to plow into the defense and throw the ball up and expect to get a foul called. That's pretty basketball. Pull up and take that short jumper.
Ferreira made the Americans all-freshman team. Marcos-Canedo will rarely shoot the ball. Williams, the spacing all a little bit off on this possession for the Bulls. The shot clock down to 5. Williams dumps it down to Weber, but she missed the layup. The putback by Jenkins. And she will draw a foul. It will be on Sheila Boykin. One on her and one on LSU, coached by Nikki Caldwell. Great player at Tennessee, has LSU in the NCAA tournament for the fourth time in her 4 years in Baton Rouge. Before that, had a very successful three-year run at UCLA.
Well, she's done a terrific job with this program. Of course, graduate of Tennessee. Had success out west, but really felt like LSU was a place where she could grow the program. She said she felt like she was really at home there. Certainly spent a lot of time telling us yesterday how much more she appreciates the value of the land maybe in Baton Rouge versus Westwood. Slightly less expensive, I'd say.
Yeah, we had a wide-ranging conversation with Coach Caldwell yesterday about real estate, about riding motorcycles
about
whether she will ever let her three-year-old daughter Justice ride a motorcycle. Her gut reaction was, no, I won't. I said, well, you better hide all the photos of you on the motorcycle that are in your house if you want to pull that one off. Number 4 is Ann Peterson for LSU. Here's Ballard. behind the screen set by Boykin.
Yeah, that was a good screen. That's exactly what you need to have happen. Give Ballard open looks. She will knock them down.
Early substitution for the Bulls, Shalithia Stringfield, who scored 20 points last time out in the American Championship game lost to UConn. Air ball by Williams. And here's LSU looking to run. Moncrief circles. Harden to Ballard. Harden for three. Rebound Ferreira in the lane. Ferreira, one of six international players on this USF team. One of three from Spain. Puts it on the deck, goes right at Boykin, and will draw the second foul on Boykin.
Let's go back to this screen here. Be set for Danielle Ballard, who's going to be up right about here when she comes up off the screen. Sheila Boykin setting the easy screen. Just come, like, that's easy basketball to me. Just come up, set the screen, give her an open look from the free throw line. She's a good pull-up jump shooter, and that's a way to get yourself involved in the game early, to get comfortable, to get confident.
Off the inbound, Williams to Jenkins. Jenkins spins and will draw the foul on Peterson. That's her first, and already three team fouls on the Lady Tigers. So Jenkins will go to the line. This is a big moment in USF history, getting to host for the first time an NCAA tournament game.
That's a lot of pressure, too, isn't it? You know, you host, so you don't want to get overwhelmed in all the hoopla and all the extracurriculars that happened this week. What's great is that we have a packed arena. You've got a lot of fans here that are here to support USF Bulls, that are here to support the NCAA tournament, women's basketball. It's a good draw. I think we have four very, very quality teams. We saw a tough one today with Louisville and BYU, a very physical match. You know, this one I think would be a little more low scoring when it comes down to it. It certainly has a capability to break open offensively, but hard sometimes for LSU to get into those scoring rhythms. It's that USF defense, too. They can be aggressive. As we saw Louisville move up the lanes, too. This is the USF feisty defensive team, too, whereas LSU is going to sit back and play a little more positioning.
In the first game, Louisville forced 30 BYU turnovers in the win. Should LSU win this one, the Louisville-LSU game in the second round here Monday will be a rematch of a Sweet 16 game a year ago won by the Cardinals. But the Lady Tigers got a lot to do before they set up that rematch. Stringfield by far the higher scoring of the two point guards for the Bulls. Jenkins with the turnaround.
Set up by Courtney Williams, who could have just as easily taken a shot, but she passed up a better one to get her teammates involved. And I think that's where Courtney Williams, her game has really evolved to a different level. She's been a scorer since she's been here on campus, but the fact that now she knows how to use her teammates better, it's really helped this team excel.
Entry pass to Bethel is knocked away and out of bounds. Timeout. 1 point LSU lead.
Bulls Raptors at 7. Thunder Spurs at 9:30.
Ballard and Courtney Williams, two guards that know how to create their own shot and really get their teammates involved too. And that's what's going to be more important in this game. You don't want to be worried about, oh, I got to get my shots, I got to get my points. And Danielle Ballard has had a knack for showing up in the NCAA tournament and going off. Last year, a couple of double-doubles. This year, 22 points, 10 rebounds against Texas A&M in the SEC quarterfinals. And where the lights are brighter and the stage is bigger, you want your players like Ballard and Courtney Williams to shine. You see some action here on the floor. The loose ball, those 50-50 balls, also so critical. You know, those are the hustle plays. You want to get those established early because that is your mindset then for the rest of the game.
Williams with the miss, and on the rebound, we're going to get a foul on USF. We already have four team fouls on LSU. Boykin has to sit on the bench because she picked up two early ones, and there's Courtney Williams' mom, Michelle. Looks very nervous watching her daughter play. And she should. This is a big game. Yeah. It's one and done. It's the beauty of this tournament, the format. You win or you go home. Alicia Jenkins will pick up her first foul. And that's number three on the Bulls. Jenkins very quietly has had an outstanding year. Williams is the best player in USF, but Jenkins isn't very far behind.
No kidding. 23 double-doubles this season. That's third most in the country.
Ballard, guarded by Williams in a terrific matchup of all-conference guards. She missed the shot, and the rebound's pulled down by Jenkins. Here they go. Tamara Taylor off the bench. She's the best three-point shooter on the Bulls. Entry pass. Bethel tried to steal it and didn't get there in time. Already 7 points for Jenkins. Seven of the Bulls, nine.
Yeah, she's very active, and she creates for a very tough matchup, especially against the zone, because USF, pretty good passing team, so Jenkins can see beyond the defense and the spacing where to make herself available, and that will be an over and back. And turnover for the Tigers.
Ball went off the foot of Moncrief. Substitution USF, Ferreira leaves, replaced by Maria Jespersen, another one of those six international players. She's from Aarhus, Denmark. Jose Fernandez has been very successful at tapping the international market. Stringfield on the drive. Can't get it to go. If that's Peterson, it's her second. And it is. So already two fouls on Peterson and two on Boykin. So the two tallest players in LSU's starting lineup have to go to the bench early with two fouls.
I looked over to the bench. Nikki Caldwell directing her players, is saying, okay, we have got to slow this thing down a little bit. Let's take your time. Don't worry, because you don't want to get into a running match either with USF. That's their game. You don't slow this thing down, this is going to be a race that I don't know that LSU wants. And they're not afraid to play with that pace. But the foul trouble, Peterson with two, Boykin with two. So now you may have to play a little bit faster because you're not going to be as big. Are you ready to handle that, though, against a USF team that might be able to play faster?
Well, she told us yesterday we're explosive in transition, and our goal is, once we get it across midcourt, is to get a good shot off within 3 seconds. The miss by Moncrief, the putback by Ann Jones. Getting some early playing time because of the foul trouble that we mentioned. And while Boykin, we're going to say, is sitting on the bench with two fouls, it's not completely true. She's sitting on the stationary bike, staying loose in the tunnel with two fouls. Williams baseline, the up and under. Rebound, Jespersen.
It's Maria Jespersen. Talk about the international flavor to this USF team. She was on the Denmark national team. Able to clean up that miss. Almost beautiful move. That might have been top 10 worthy from Courtney Williams had she put that one in. She was hanging up there in the air for, seemed like, 3 to 5 seconds.
Shot clock inside 10. Circus shot by Ballard goes in.
And that's her strength. Her strength is more athleticism, you know, that big body presence, can take a lot of contact and still find a way to get a look.
She's got six already. Jenkins' entry pass is stolen by Ballard. That is her. So she's an even better thief at the defensive end of the floor than she's a scorer at the offensive end. Ballard, we mentioned she missed the first 14 games with a suspension because of violation of team rules, and yet she's got 47 steals. Shot clock inside 10 again. Ballard changed hands on the dribble. Rebound winds up in the hands of Jenkins. Here's Stringfield up the sideline to Williams. The pull-up.
Yes. Yes, Courtney Williams. Yes, that is exactly what you're supposed to do in the fast break. And mom's going to stay nervous over there way too early to crack a smile.
USF by three. Another steal. Here's Taylor. Will anyone catch her? She's fouled by Bethel. For Bethel, that's her first. Already six team fouls. The Women's Basketball Championship will continue tomorrow on ESPN2. In our early window at noon Eastern time, you'll get a chance to see Duke, who barely survived an opening round scare from Albany. They'll take on fifth seed Mississippi State, and the number 11 Miami, who upset Washington in the first round, will be in action as well. So Duke had the scare but survived. And there are eight teams in this tournament in the ACC, Brooke, and all eight of them, including Louisville, earlier today on this floor, all eight won their opening round game.
Yeah, the ACC, probably the strongest conference out there. You know, the SEC strong as well, the Pac-12 stepping up, excuse me. But the ACC, you got Notre Dame, you know, who's you lock them in, I think, for a Final Four spot. And the way that Muffet McGraw has developed that program as well, certainly Louisville there.
Florida State,
a strong team this year.
Bethel sets the high screen. Jenna Deemer, number one, 13, Rena Hill in off the bench for LSU. And a rebound over the back foul will be called on Jones. That's one on her. That's seven on the team. Already in the bonus. Timeout. To break the single season record held by that young lady, Jessica Dixon, who was the star player on USF's first NCAA tournament team in 2006 and is now an administrative assistant on Jose Fernandez's staff.
Yeah, Jessica Dixon was such a dynamic player. She was a scorer. You just could not keep her away from the rim. No matter what defense you threw at her, she was able to use her athleticism, her talent, her basketball smarts, all of those combined, and it made her one of the more dynamic all-around players and somebody that was so fun to watch. And you'd see her and you'd think, okay, well, is today the day she could go off for 40?
The outlet pass by Jones was stolen, then knocked on the floor. Wild scramble. USF comes away with it. Springfield kept it alive. Williams is trapped in the corner and somehow escaped and finds Jess Person for the layup. How'd she do that?
Terrific effort on the 50-50 ball. Courtney Williams staying with the play, and then the heads up. Look ahead to Maria Jesperson. But the answer by Danielle Ballard. This LSU squad, tough. Nikki Caldwell ripping into her team during the timeout. She was all over them, Bob, about the rebounding margin. She really felt like her team not doing a good enough job on the boards. USF up 9-5 right now in terms of rebounding. So they got some work to do if you're LSU.
Taylor misses the deep three, and here's Ballard at the other end. And Nikki told us yesterday, the way to offset USF's rebounding prowess is in your shot selection. Take good shots, knock down shots, and there won't be any rebounds to be had.
That's because the Bulls average 30 defensive rebounds a game. So what that means is just that right there. You get one chance, one and done. One of the better double-double machines in the country in Alicia Jenkins.
The stop-and-go move by Stringfield, and she will draw a foul on Bethel, and that's her second and eight on the team. Now, how did Williams... This is like a Houdini move.
Well, she stayed with the play, and she's able to keep her calm.
Oop.
That's right. Just going to break through four, maybe even five LSU players. So look ahead. Jesperson, who likes that play. And, so does that man.
And Jose Fernandez nearly knocked himself over in celebrating that basket. He reached way down, and I don't even know how to describe it. It was like a little Baryshnikov move, a little pirouette, and he nearly lost his balance and did a header.
Just feels comfortable on his own floor, Bob, you know? You do things at home you wouldn't do maybe on the road.
At least he did it without tearing his Achilles tendon, unlike
right.
Georgia State men's coach Ron Hunter.
It's not funny, but I can't help it. He's such a great personality, too.
Who are you talking about, Ron Hunter or Jose?
Both.
Both.
Yeah, both. But I'm just meeting Ron Hunter now for the first time.
Moncrief to Hill. Harden gets the screen and the step back from the foul line. And way up in the air for the rebound is Williams. And on the open floor, Hill drew a charge from Weber. And Hill really paid the price. She went down hard. She might have hit the back of her head on the floor. That's called stepping in and taking a charge.
Yeah, let's watch this play again because it could be Rena Hill just, yep, paying attention.
Ooh.
Yep, she was absolutely able to pay attention. And then you see Caitlin Weber kind of falling on top of her at the end of the play. That's where she hit her head. Not on the initial contact, on the fall down after, but that's it. I would try to catch people all the time doing that. If you're not paying attention, I would stand right in front of you, let you knock me over, and I get the call for the charge. It was a great feeling. I mean, physically, not so much for me, but
Hill is 10 inches shorter than Weber. The miss by Moncrief, and here's Williams looking to go. Wants to go right at the rim. Can't get it to go. Weber can't keep the ball inbounds. The NCAA Wrestling Championships will conclude tonight in St. Louis. You can catch the final coming up in just about an hour at 8 Eastern time on ESPN and watch ESPN. And special off-the-mat coverage on ESPN3. And you can visit NCAA.com. It's your home for all 89 NCAA championships. Jones set the high screen. Hill with the shot clock at 10. Puts it on the deck. And we're going to get a foul call on Jasmine Rhodes. Stringfield stepped in for the steal, and Rhodes tried to get it back. That's one on her. That's already 9 team fouls.
Rena Hill trying to get a solid screen set for Mann Jones, so she kind of waves her up to come to the top of the key. But the problem was the screen wasn't really a screen. It was just sort of facing the other basket. You got to get on one side or the other so you can give her some room to work with. And now they're going to be back in the game. LSU needing some easy shots. They need to perhaps slow this game down a little bit to try and open up this USF defense. I know Nikki Caldwell is okay with pace. But you wonder if you go pace for pace, if USF might have an easier time with getting the win versus trying to slow them down and making them beat you in the quarter court.
Shalethia Stringfield has come back from 2 torn ACL surgeries. You see the very heavy brace on her right knee. She gives them scoring firepower off the bench. Had 20 in a rare start against UConn in the American Conference Championship game. This foul will be on Jenkins. And for her, it is her 2nd. And 5 on the team. So to the line will go Danielle Ballard. And as we mentioned, suspended for the first 14 games, the non-conference portion of the season, for a violation of team rules. We talked to Nikki Caldwell yesterday. We asked her about that decision. She said it was cut and dry. I feel as a coach that I have to teach my players that there are real consequences for what you do. She paid her price. She's back. We move forward, and she has done everything right since she's been back. Her attitude has been commendable, but she had to pay a heavy price, and her teammates felt empathy for her, but they also understood why the decision to suspend her for that many games had to be made.
Yeah, I mean, clearly it was a big enough violation that Nikki Caldwell felt that she had to send a message, and that's not real easy for a coach to do, to just bench your star player, because a lot of that responsibility for those wins and losses, they fall back to you as the head coach. So Nikki Caldwell sees the bigger picture and the bigger message to say, yeah, I know you're my best player. You can't mess around.
Williams with the jumper. What a dynamic player she is at 5'8". Unbelievable jumping ability, unbelievable quickness.
She's very graceful, too, when she shoots. And, you know, I think for her, her next level is to get thicker. You know, she needs to put some weight on, get in the weight room. Not so much that it slows her game down, but just so more that she's able to take contact. If she wants to play at the professional level, that's what it's going to take. Just to give you an example, that one dribble pull-up. I mean, look how long her arms are.
You think that's jumping? How about this?
You got one better? Oh, okay.
The old box jump.
Oh, come on, Bob. You know you did that in the hotel this morning. I saw you in the gym.
No, you didn't.
You're right, I didn't. I was in there by myself. What was that, 53 inches on that box jump, though?
I believe the official is 54 inches.
Okay.
Right?
I don't want a shorter.
When you get over 50, you know, who counts?
Right. That's impressive. Yeah, she could dunk a tennis ball, too.
Weber knocks down the free throws. So USF has opened up a 12-point lead, in part taking advantage of foul trouble on LSU's bigs. Sheila Boykin and Peterson, quick exit from the game, 2 fouls each. Bethel off the bench, another post player, also 2 fouls. Foot was on the line. It's a long two for Hart. Quickly the other way. Stringfield with the runner. Rebound pulled down by Moncrief, knocked away, and comes to Ballard, and a double dribble call.
And Courtney Williams, one of the more athletic players you'll see in this tournament. She's already been impressing us on the court. Off the court, yeah, she got little hops.
In that ice pack.
It's Mariah Morey in your screen there, the talented freshman. Louisville, another nice performance from a freshman too. Maisha Hines-Allen finishes today, 19 points, 8 rebounds on 8 of 12 shooting.
Those two freshmen instrumental in Louisville's third place finish in the deep and talented ACC. The air ball by Taylor, and it will go back to the Lady Tigers.
We mentioned LSU needing to kind of get things broken up offensively. They've been limited to just one shot, or they've turned it over. Now they've had 25 possessions. They've done one shot or turned it over in 24 of those 25 possessions. So USF doing a good job of doing what they do best. The defensive rebounds, the one and done.
Harden for three. In and out. Tough rebound in traffic by Ballard. Air ball on the jump shot from the perimeter by Ann Jones. And here's Courtney Williams. No one has picked her up yet. Reverses it to Taylor. Shot clock at 10 for Stringfield. Weber calling for the ball in the low block. Instead, it comes up top to Stringfield with 5 in the shot clock. Stringfield with the fade. And the rebound comes down to Hart. Goes behind the back. Ballard, crossover dribble to Moncrief. Hill sets up Jones, who goes around Weber.
So that was a possession for LSU that they took their time, tried to reverse the ball one side or the other, but they didn't force a bad shot. That's what Nikki Caldwell was talking about, to get better quality shots. And we have a tie up here under the basket.
And on the possession arrow, it will go back to LSU. Boykin comes back in. She picked up 2 early fouls and immediately went to the bench after playing only 3 minutes. So Nikki Caldwell rolling the dice a little bit, but putting Boykin back in with just under 6 minutes remaining first half of their team trailing by 8. Four guards and Boykin on the floor right now for LSU. And Weber will be called for the bump on the perimeter. That's her second. And number 6 on USF. So Moncrief will inbound right in front of the USF bench. Hill baseline. Jesperson allowed her no room to go. Last touch by Jesperson. Terrific defense.
Without fouling, too. You know, so many times these players, they drive and get bailed out by that foul. But defensively, if you just hold your position and let them shoot that shot, and that's exactly what I'm talking about. That's terrific defense. Let Ballard go into traffic, shoot, but turn around and try to grab that rebound quickly.
The rebound comes out in the hands of Taylor, who finally knocks one down. She had been ice cold to start the night. Ten-point lead for the Bulls, who are 1-1 in the first round in their first two appearances in the NCAA tournament. 2 years ago, they beat Texas Tech and then lost a heartbreaker to Cal in the second round. Williams with the pull-up on the baseline. Timeout, LSU.
Wow. That play from Courtney Williams, that was so unbelievably impressive. Bob.
She needs 9 more to tie, 10 more to break the single-season record held by Jessica Dixon. Nikki Caldwell said of Williams, she can score in multiple ways, and she draws so much attention from the defense that she creates great opportunities for her teammates.
Yeah, and that's where Alicia Jenkins jumps in and says, yeah, I'll take some offensive rebounds when you're not hitting your layups. That's a big-time basket and much-needed one for Tayshaun Harden and LSU, who find themselves down 10 here in the first early half.
On the long rebound, Taylor tries to keep it alive and does. Gives to Courtney Williams with the fake and the runner.
Not that jab step. She will shake you off in a step.
The steal by Taylor. Lead back up to 12. Last touch by LSU. Third round action in the NCAA Division I's basketball championship is continuing tonight on CBS, TBS, and TNT. Kentucky remains undefeated. Cincinnati hung in there for a long time this afternoon with the Wildcats. And John Calipari's club is on to the Sweet 16. Taylor, another air ball on a three. And earlier today, Princeton remaining undefeated in the women's bracket with a win over Green Bay, with President Obama in attendance to watch his niece Leslie's Princeton Tigers team.
You know, they keep rolling on. Courtney Bangard and that Princeton Tiger program doing some terrific things and getting a win against a quality Green Bay team. And we'll move on, maybe have a chance to knock off Maryland. For right now, Courtney Williams, watch this move, the jab step. 1-2, you can't check with me.
Six wins this season. They went 15-3 in the American Athletic Conference, finished in second place. And they played in a conference tournament championship game for the first time in school history. That's the good news. Bad news is they had to play against the University of Connecticut in that game. And the even worse news, the game was in the state of Connecticut.
This is one of the better USF teams that's been around. There's best season since 08-09. They had 20 wins before March even hit.
The jumper by Deemer is good. So with the early foul trouble, Nikki Caldwell has had to go small with her lineup, and Deemer getting some early action, and Williams with two more.
And that was over 6'1" Ann Peterson.
She's got 10. She's five away from the single season record. And a quick basket by the Lady Tigers, but they're down 10. They can't match baskets. So far, Brooke, we have not a single three-point field goal make in this game,
which is surprising. Certainly USF, a three-point shooting team, but they've been able to get inside the line.
They're 0-for-8 now. Not surprising for LSU. That's not really part of their repertoire, the three-point make. Lady Tigers are 313th in the country in three-point field goals, and will get a shoving foul. Coming up on the Northwestern Mutual Halftime Report with Kevin Nagant, Carol Lawson, Rebecca Lobo. They'll bring you up to date on the three other games in progress around the country. Cal State, Northridge, and Stanford, Ohio, and Arizona State. And Seton Hall and Rutgers in a battle of the Garden State. And there's some talk that perhaps those two schools, who no longer are in the same conference, will continue that rivalry on an annual basis.
I sure hope so, because it's nice to see how competitive Seton Hall is, too. You know, we had mentioned some teams in the Big East, that were kind of more toward the bottom, and for years Seton Hall was unable to get off the basement level of the Big East. So good job to them. And certainly Rutgers, a very physical, athletic, powerful team. And if you see Rutgers advance, maybe a second round matchup again with Connecticut, which everybody's hoping, hey, if you can't win, can you at least wear them down for us? Can you get them to 40-50% by the time they get to the Sweet 16?
Problem with that is in the NCAA tournament, you play two games in 3 days and then you have another 5 or 6 days off. So the wear down effect isn't
quite as powerful, right?
Easily to achieve between the second round and the Sweet 16. We got a foul there on Harden. That is two on her. And 11 on the team. So we got 1, 2, 3, 4 LSU players with two fouls each. Bethel, Peterson, Harden, and Boykin. It's reflected in the free throw numbers. USF at the line now. That's the 17th free throw attempt for the Bulls. The Tigers have two.
I hear Nikki Caldwell over there. I believe she just kept saying 17, 17 in reference to the number of free throw attempts.
Well, sometimes a team has fewer free throw attempts than the other team. It's because they foul more.
Is that so?
And it's not because of bad officiating.
USF's been aggressive. They've done a better job of getting all the way to the rim or finding a way to make contact. LSU has been able to penetrate the three-point line, but has not been able to get much into the paint. And that's been one of the differences in this game.
Boykin calling for the ball down low. They can't get it to her. Shot clock inside 10. And Peterson knocks down the three. That's her 12th of the year. So both Peterson and Boykin back on the floor with two fouls for LSU.
And Peterson could be a nice little X factor for the Tigers, because she's not somebody you pay attention to and you think, oh, well, she's going to shoot the ball. She didn't have any points last game, but she has started 26, 27 games this season. So she's out there as one of their veteran players, junior out of Denmark. And you know, she could be somebody to help open this offense up.
Offensive foul on Shavonte Naylor. Good call.
Certainly a call from referees where Boykin may not have been into place. Certainly seemed like she was still trying to get there.
Williams around the screen. In traffic, thought the better of it. Then gets her pocket pick, goes down hard, is yet to get up. Ballard misses. Williams is now back up. Looks like she might be wincing. She is definitely wincing.
Yeah, she fell down big time, hard on her right side.
Down low, Ballard just tried to get the draw foul. It didn't work, and now Williams comes away with it. Well, she looks a little less uncomfortable than she did. I wonder if Jose Fernandez will use his first half timeout here. Doesn't look like it. Nope, he does. So with 15 left on the shot clock, 30 on the game clock. And let's get another look at when Williams went down hard when she was stripped at midcourt.
Yeah, she kind of got caught hanging around. That's the first spill from Courtney Williams, and you see her grabbing her left elbow. Just a minute ago, she fell on her right side. Certainly not affecting the shooting much of Courtney Williams.
15 on the shot clock. What do you think Jose Fernandez drew up in that huddle?
Well, I just think he's going to take the best shot that's going to be available to them. You know, for Jose Fernandez, he really emphasizes trying to get to the rim, but to not take sloppy shots. And this USF Bulls team, they've stayed aggressive.
It's a third foul on Peterson. And to the line will go Tamara Taylor, senior from nearby St. Petersburg. So Peterson will depart with that third foul. LSU has one more possession left, and besides not wanting to pick up the fourth foul on Peterson, Nikki Caldwell wants another scorer on the floor from the perimeter in Rena Hill. Boykin rebounds the missed free throw. Shot clock off. LSU will play 4-1 to try to cut it to 6, which would be not a bad deal with all the foul trouble and the free throw disparity. Moncrief spins, gets the Boykin screen. The kick out to Deemer, no good. Rebound knocked away by Jess Person with 1.2 seconds remaining. So LSU needs a quick hitter here. Comes to Moncrief. The one-timer is good. How about that play?
It's a heads-up play right there. Knowing how much time's on the clock, you don't have a whole lot of time to catch and shoot.
So after trailing by as many as 12.
Get to the free throw line 20 times to just 4 for LSU. So that has got to change here in the second half. Your LSU, Courtney Williams, kind of feeling it right now. She's got 10 points here in the first half on her home floor. She likes it.
USF 0-for-8 from three-point range in the first 20 minutes. Otherwise, it would be a significantly larger lead. LSU got into big-time foul trouble. Sheila Boykin picked up an early two. So did Ann Peterson. Peterson later picked up her third. And Courtney Williams entering the second half needs only 5 more points to break the USF single-season scoring record. Jenkins with the miss, but another offensive rebound for the Bulls. And the first three of the night for USF. It took nearly 21 minutes.
And the ball almost took 21 minutes to come back down. How about the arc from Laura Ferreira?
Moncrief. And look at Williams get up in the air for that rebound.
Just sky over 6'1" and Peterson.
Ferreira looking for another three. Will Nicky Caldwell get an early timeout here? Now they're going to try to play through it. No, nope, she is going to use a timeout. The lead was 12 in the first half. A run by LSU cut it to 6 at halftime. And just like that, we played 64 seconds of the second half. Lead back up to a dozen.
This is a freshman player out of...
A lot of smiles on that USF bench, and why not? They begin the second half with a 6-0 run, prompting Nicky Caldwell to call timeout. She didn't spend a whole lot of the timeout talking to her troops, Brooke.
Well, there's only so much you can say. You got to get to a point where you were going to go out there and make plays. And you come out of the timeout with a turnover. And that look says it all right there.
Turnovers a huge factor in our first game in Tampa. BYU committed 30 of them in a 33-point loss to Louisville. The Cardinals will meet the winner of this one in the second round right here on this floor on Monday night. Jenkins, look at that move to the goal.
A couple of moves involved in that play combined with the explosiveness of Alicia Jenkins. She had a ball fake, one dribble, and then really used her body while to finesse in between two, maybe three LSU players on her way to the rim.
An 8-0 run to start the second half, and an offensive foul. If it's Peterson, it's her fourth. It is. Foul number 4 on Peterson. Could the second half possibly get off to a worse start for Nicky Caldwell's team?
This is tough. Laura Marcos Canedo. Well, looks to me like she just lost her balance. I don't know that that would necessarily be an offensive foul on Ann Peterson. That didn't look like it warranted much of a call either way. She got it. And another touch foul here.
Bumping foul on Moncrief. 1 on her, 2 on LSU this half. So the lead has gone from 6 to 14 in the first minute 49 of the second half. And it's the biggest lead of the night. First NCAA tournament home game in USF history. Williams with the pull-up. The rebound deflected by Harden to Moncrief. 3-on-3 for the Lady Tigers. Harden behind the Boykin screen for 3.
This LSU team not willing to go away. They're going to fight. They just need some help offensively. They need some easy buckets in transition if they can get a turnover. And really for them where it's going to start is trying to manage the basketball because there's been too many unforced turnovers for LSU.
Full court pressure. Ferreira, who made the Americans all-freshman team. Ball off the foot of LSU with 24 to shoot.
He's just watching that play right there, watching Ferreira bring the ball up the floor. Ball in her left hand. She looked uncomfortable. So guess what I'm doing? Every time she touches that ball, I'm going to make you beat me left. Because I just saw a little subtlety. Your left hand's not all that strong, so I'm going to make you go left. Courtney Williams, she's good either way. You've got to just play physically with her.
Weber set the screen for Marcos Canedo. They'll give her that shot. The rebound, Jenkins then has it stripped from her by Ballard. Harden to Ballard on the wing, knocked loose. Here's Williams, has Jenkins ahead of everyone. Gets it to her for the layup. Points for Jenkins, the second team All-American Athletic Conference performer. Ballard.
Smart move by LSU, trying to change up your defense a little bit. Ferreira to that left side.
Well, they will give Marcos Canedo that shot until she proves she can knock it down. Here's Moncrief, 3-on-3. Lost the handle, gets it back. Harden for 3. And just like that, the lead is down to 8.
So a couple of outside shots from LSU. They are not going to shake their confidence.
LSU has been to the round of 32 the last 3 years. Sweet 16 the last 2 years. Ferreira has 6 points this half. Up in the air is Williams.
Oh, my gosh. Wow. And she's all into this game, too. Courtney Williams feeling so good playing at home. elevation. She's got some hops.
And Ballard with the answer.
Wow, that was a good answer, too, from Ballard. She's keeping her calm out there.
Ferreira to Jenkins. The pull-up in the lane. Offensive rebound, Weber, and one.
Courtney Williams 3 points away from breaking. Not only that, you got 16 second chance points, so they are converting those. And you know, we knew Alicia Jenkins was going to be a terrific rebounder, but Caitlin Weber having a big game.
And her story is one of persistence.
Yeah, no question about it. She spent a lot of time in and out of the hospital this year, trying to deal with, you know, with an illness that caused her to lose her appetite, and she wasn't able to really, you know, get into basketball shape. Lost some weight coming into the season, but then to try to adjust out there on the floor with, you know, a different body frame, trying to deal with the amount of medications you're taking and all of that while trying to fight through illness. That's been tough, but she's come into this game, asserted herself, you know, not done anything huge, but she's gotten a rebound here or there. She's gotten on the floor a couple of times. Hustle plays.
Williams can't get it to go, and the rebound is yanked down by Bethel for LSU, the transfer from West Virginia. Moncrief around the Bethel screen, blows by Jesperson, can't finish. Offensive rebound, Jones. Loose on the floor, held ball, and on the possession arrow, it will stay at this end of the floor. The road to the Frozen Four ices up tomorrow with the NCAA Hockey Championship Selection Show at noon Eastern on ESPNU and watch ESPN. And you can visit NCAA.com, the home for all 89 NCAA championships. 28 seconds left on the shot clock. For the Lady Tigers, Rena Hill, the first Japanese player in LSU and SEC history. Number 13 back on the floor for the Lady Tigers. To the cutter, Jones, and she will draw the foul. And it will be on Stringfield. Her first, and one on the Bulls this half. To the line will go Ann Jones, a 6'3 junior from Jackson, Tennessee. Jose Fernandez, in chatting with us yesterday, said LSU is a lot better than the record indicates. Remember, they didn't have Ballard for any of those non-conference losses. And remember, there were seven of them. They lost 13 games, seven of them in non-league play during Ballard's suspension.
He gave Ray Jean Moncrief, Deshaun Harden, an opportunity to take over the shot selection. That's good ball movement right there. The assist from Alicia Jenkins down into Maria Jesperson. But this LSU squad, you know, it is led by guards, led by Danielle Ballard. But Deshaun Harden able to step up, Ray Jean Moncrief doing the same. And you saw how organized LSU was when they came back. 10 wins in the SEC, not easy to do.
And away from the play, Jenkins is going to pick up her third foul and two on the team. Well, since Ballard returned in the 16 games, not including this one, two players you mentioned, Harden and Moncrief, along with Ballard, have accounted for 58% of LSU's points. And the layup by Hill. And just like that, the lead is back to nine. LSU, by the way, has quite a streak on the line here. They have won their last 16 NCAA tournament openers as Jesperson hits for the Bulls.
She looks comfortable out there as well. Now she's trying to change up their defense a little bit. Looking like putting Ann Jones at the top. Maybe the 3-2 looking zone to try to get bigger up front.
Moncrief with the runner. Offensive rebound, Jones. As she went up, it was knocked away by Jenkins, who was very fortunate she didn't get her fourth foul.
We see Jenkins trying to plead her case, saying, hey, you know, I'm getting a little bit of contact on the way up there. I just want to let you know. As a player, you know, sometimes you gotta drop little subtle hints and nuggets, you know, and try and get yourself a call here and there.
Jones puts it on the deck and is stripped, and here's Williams off to the races. Feeds Ferreira, and a blocking foul will be called on Rena Hill. One on her, and four on LSU. USF, one of three teams in the American Athletic Conference in the NCAA tournament. Obviously, UConn is one, and the other one is Tulane in its first year in the league. On the rebound, knocked out of bounds by LSU. The SEC has seven teams in the NCAA tournament. Ferreira was looking for her third three of the second half.
That shot, too easy for Ferreira. I heard Nikki Caldwell screaming to her players, hey, look in the corner. And she get a good, quick response, too, from this shot for quick bucket LSU. You know, certainly not out of this game whatsoever. It just seems to me, though, that USF in so much control of the shot they want. LSU is taking the shot they're getting. USF's taking the shot they want.
Spacing a little off on this possession. Williams for three, and there's the record. Courtney Williams has just broken the USF single season record for most points held previously by Jessica Dixon. 683 points is the new record.
It's pretty amazing, Bob. A lot of players don't do that for their career.
Hill fouled Stringfield. Boy, Bethel just didn't hustle on that play. The ball was headed into the backcourt. It would have been a over and back on LSU, and Bethel didn't bother chasing down the Stringfield, and Hill had no choice but to foul. There's Mom Michelle. Maybe she doesn't realize her daughter is now the single-season scoring leader in USF history.
Hey, no smiles from Mom, no smiles from Courtney, unless it's in a timeout and you're on the bench and you can afford to have a little fun, but it's too serious. We're only up 12 here, 12 and a half minutes left, which, you know, to a mom is an absolute eternity. Courtney Williams now on her 683rd point, passing up a dynamic player in Jessica Dixon, one of the best. Certainly leave here, but to make her mark, too, in the Big East.
There's Jessica, who's an administrative assistant on this staff. Her uniform number hangs from the rafters here. Number 25, she wore. After this free throw, another offensive rebound for the Bulls, and we get a fresh 30. Time for Williams to retie her left shoe. And she even does that quickly. And she did that in about 3.5 seconds.
Right. Jose Fernandez looking over to his players and saying, hey, relax.
Williams looking for two more. Offensive rebound, Weber.
Rena Hill not able to box out. At that point, just too much hype. Caitlin Weber, 6'4 to 5'4.
Weber sets the high screen for Stringfield. Jess Person puts it on the deck. Ferreira to Williams with the pull-up. Rebound Moncrief. And here they come. Stringfield tried to draw the charge, but it won't work. This time, she'll be called for the block. Courtney Williams, now the leading single-season scorer in USF history. Timeout. Her Bulls up 12. And was an honorable mention All-American. First team All-AAC again this year as a junior. Had a 34-point game against Penn State, another 34 against East Carolina. There are six players who were selected to the American Athletic Conference's all-conference team, and only two were not from UConn, and Courtney Williams was one of the two. Jose Fernandez is quick to point out, and I would if I were him also, his team has lost seven games, three of them to the best team in the country, UConn, and Stringfield is. I mean, everybody loses to UConn, so they only lost four games to someone other than UConn. That's not bad.
The Bulls have had a very strong season. We mentioned it. Their best season since 08, 09, getting those 20 wins before March even rolls around.
Ballard with the runner.
It's pretty amazing to watch how Jose Fernandez takes a team that basically looks completely different every 2 years, because he utilizes a lot of junior college players, a lot of international players that come in, you know, some transfers here and there. And no matter what, he's always able to get them to play hard defensively. He's always got a player or two offensively that can really shoot it. The three balls there, shooting guards, kind of the complete package for USF, and he's able to blend all of those styles into a good-looking product that we're watching here on the floor today.
Williams and Jenkins certainly exceptions to that. They're going to be around for 4 years. And between them, they're going to break a lot of records, each with 1 year to go. Williams from the corner. Rebound, Jenkins. Seventh rebound for Jenkins. She had a 21-rebound game against Penn State. Halfway through the second half, the winner of this one gets Louisville in the second round on Monday night. Williams had the ball knocked away as she was on her way up. Still managed to get it up on the rim. Ballard goes at Ferrero, hit the side of the backboard. Rebound Stringfield. Doubled. Weber sets the screen for Ferrero. Williams to Weber in the lane.
USF starting to look like they're running out of energy here in the second half. And it's a good call right now for Nikki Caldwell. Try and rally your troops here. It's the energy level looking a little despondent for the LSU bench. I heard Taurasi make a comment. Diana Taurasi, one of the all-time greats at UConn, said, hey, listen, if nobody gets them the rest of this year, I think Brianna Stewart has a chance to leave her senior career unblemished.
The same would be true for Mariah Jefferson, who came in with Brianna. The miss by Jones. The offensive rebound by Boykin is no good. Stringfield gets knocked down, and the Lady Tigers still have possession. Deemer for three. Hill out hustles everyone to get the rebound, and it results in a shot by Deemer and a foul. Great hustle by Hill.
She's been a very active player out there, giving them the effort and energy when it started to fade a little bit. Danielle Ballard on the bench for this LSU team. Regina Hill stepped in the game, trying to exert a little more energy. Deshaun Harden still one of the starters that's in right now. Jenna Deemer, their three-point shooter in the game to try and knock down some shots. You see in the face of Danielle Ballard. She looks exhausted.
Well, they haven't played since the last game in the SEC tournament when they were eliminated back on March 7th. That's always situation that's true with everyone in the NCAA women's tournament. There's that long gap between the end of the conference tournaments, particularly if somehow you get upset early in your conference tournament, but you're still good enough to make the NCAA. And you have that long layoff to the start of the NCAA tournament. The reverse is true of men's basketball, where Wisconsin, for example, won the Big Ten championship late Sunday afternoon, and 20 minutes later they're watching the selection show to find out who they're going to play on Friday night.
Yeah, and they made quick work of Coastal Carolina, which I think everybody expected.
Much to your chagrin.
Yeah.
Proud alum.
It's all good. We'll be back.
Wisconsin trying to get back to the Final Four for a second straight year, this time as a number one seed. Jesperson down low, Jenkins. Hill knocked it away. Hill is all over the place. Another held ball. The Arrow will keep it at the USF end with 17 to shoot.
Yeah, you don't want to make an entry pass. Number one, Alisi Jenkins surrounded by LSU players. If you are going to make that pass in the post, I like to see it come from the wing and a bounce pass, but she's got better position to do something with it when she catches it.
Stringfield to Williams. Jesperson set the screen. Shot clock at 10. Ferreira with the pull-up. Rebound pulled down by Ann Jones. Here's Harden with a pull-up three. Air ball back to the Bulls.
Nikki Caldwell looking right at her, saying, hey, pass the ball. It's a quick shot, something you don't want. I understand you're trying to build a little oomph, a little offense, something, some kind of spark. Deshaun Harden, you know, she felt good enough to transition to take that pull-up, but it's not the shot you want to take.
chess person, put it on the floor, and created some space for herself. 10 points for her off the bench. Her fifth double-figure scoring performance of the year. 14-point Bulls lead. Winner gets Louisville on Monday. If it's USF, it'll be a rematch of the American Athletic Conference semifinals last year. Cardinals won that one. Shot clock at three. Jenkins deflects the pass. And LSU loses it over the sideline. Another turnover, number 14. Timeout. The Bulls in control. Dance-a-thon with the first NCAA tournament home game in USF history. And the dance-a-thon's taking place right here inside the USF Sun Dome. They're up in the end zone, and they've been standing on their feet the entire game. I'm not sure they're dancing the whole time, but they have yet to sit. And the dance-a-thon will continue until 11 o'clock tonight for a good cause.
Shouldn't get any more coincidental, right? I mean, what do you say when you make the NCAA tournament?
Let's go dancing. It started at 11 this morning, the dance-a-thon, and it will continue. They got another couple of hours. Shot clock down to two. Ferreira with one, and she barely gets it off. Jespersen with the rebound. Blocked by Boykin, but a foul. So third foul. There you go. They've yet to sit.
Need more music.
Very good crowd here tonight. As we mentioned earlier this evening, this is a new format for the NCAA Women's Tournament. For the first time, they don't announce the sites in advance. They announce them the night of the selection show. And the top 16 seeds get to host. There's one exception. Louisville is one of those top 16 seeds, the number 3 seed in the Albany region. Cardinals can't host because their arena, the KFC Yum Center, is hosting NCAA men's tournament games this weekend. So USF got to host as a result. But you can't sell tickets in advance, because you don't know you're hosting, and the NCAA doesn't let you sell them, even in anticipating that you might host. Off the steal, Harden with the basket. So with all that said, there's a pretty good crowd tonight when they've never had an NCAA tournament home game in the history of the school.
Yeah, well represented and supported, but that's what we expected. You know, Jose Fernandez told us that yesterday. So this place is going to be packed tomorrow. Just you watch. The way USF's playing right now, they are looking to be back here Monday night.
And in another 15 days, the Final Four will take place in Tampa, downtown at the Amalie Arena. Off another Bulls turnover. Boykin to Hill. Jones hands to Harden. Shot clock inside 7. Harden with the spin move. And on the floor, Moncrief controls, gives back to Harden for the miss. And finally, Williams comes away with it.
You know, Harden had an easier shot. She had a screen set up for her by Sheila Boykin. She could have taken that screen, gone to the right in the middle of the paint. Instead, she makes it harder. She goes left and then has to spin move to try to go over back to the right shoulder, and she runs right into traffic. You know, there are easy shots to be taken. That's why I preach about the mid-range so much, especially with a screen.
Ferreira for 3. Another offensive rebound for Jespersen. She has been terrific tonight.
She has been so big on the boards, and somebody, you know, you're not going to pay a lot of attention to in the scouting report because you're so worried about Courtney Williams. You're worried about Alicia Jenkins, and then Laura Ferreira comes in. She knocks down threes, and Jespersen comes in off the bench ready to rebound. Deep USF Bulls team.
Shot clock inside 10 again. Springfield with the shot fake and hits the pull-up.
She took a note out of the page of Courtney Williams in her book, in that mid-range. Simple ball fake. Nikki Caldwell needing a 20-second timeout once again to try and keep her team alive in this one.
One reason I think she called the timeout is she had 1, 2, 3, 4 players sitting at the scorer's table ready to come in. And she wants to see some new faces in there. She doesn't like what the current crew's doing.
Shalithia Stringfield. See, just that subtle head fake, just kind of like raising your chin up a little bit. Your eyes go to the rim. That's all it takes. It doesn't have to be anything dramatic, just the sell. And then instead of going all the way into traffic and throwing it up and hoping to get called for the foul, and hoping to make the layup, instead you pull up a nice, pretty little jumper.
LSU has missed 10 of its last 11 shots. They've used 10 different starting lineups this season. They won more than two games in a row only one time all season. They led South Carolina by four at the half in the SEC tournament, wound up losing by 20. In fact, the first thing Nikki Caldwell said to us when we saw her yesterday at practice and we asked her, how you doing? She said, I'm doing great because we don't have to play South Carolina here.
Yeah.
They played them three times this year and they came away 0-3.
They were able to get some big wins, beating Texas A&M two times in a row to end the regular season and again in the SEC tournament.
Shot clock down to three. Doesn't get to the rim, and that's a shot clock violation. You mentioned Texas A&M, by the way. The Aggies upset in the opening round of the NCAA tournament today by Arkansas Little Rock. Jenkins. Shot was blocked by Jones with 21 seconds left on the shot clock. Somebody needs the inbound for the Bulls. Decanter is saying, let's go. I can't throw it in. Stringfield finds a wide open Ferreira.
Well, that's about the 4-3 we've seen come oh so close for Ferreira after she knocked down two to start this second half, and LSU all but falling apart here.
Turnover number 16 for LSU. Bulls have outscored the Lady Tigers in points off turnovers, 14-4. Turnovers were the story in the first game. Louisville turned BYU over 30 times and won by 33. Jenkins cuts, gets the ball, and is fouled. So Jenkins will shoot a couple of free throws when we return in Tampa.
Up to 75%.
Williams to take between maybe 20, 25 shots a game.
At the line, Jenkins, her coach, Jose Fernandez, says every time the ball goes up, she thinks the rebound belongs to her. She is relentless. Barring an injury, she will become the leading rebounder in USF history next year. She entered the night needing only 128 to break Wanda Guyton's record. And so far tonight, she's got seven boards.
Yeah, it's pretty hard to believe this is just a junior. So you're going to get to see her play all next season, too, and really improve on those numbers and become, you know, a shooter. 23 shots a game. You want to see her make 15 of those.
Weber with the miss, and here comes Harden. Two on two, has Deemer to her left. Harden with the pull up. Williams batted the rebound over the end line, and it will stay at the LSUN. Later tonight, UConn will begin its quest for a third straight title and national championship number 10. The Huskies will take on St. Francis of Brooklyn. The entire nation will be able to see that at 9 o'clock Eastern time on ESPN2 from Gamble Pavilion and Stores, where Rutgers and Seton Hall are really going at it in the first game. Scarlet Knights up 5 with a little over 3 minutes left. Williams drives, Ballard knocked it away with 22 to shoot.
She's got so much explosiveness to her game. It looked like she was about to take off and dunk that ball. Now, we know she can dunk a tennis ball. Okay, so you can't put past a basketball. I mean, it is a possibility. She can touch the rim. She can dunk a tennis ball. Then, you know, it is possible.
Weber's doubled, and it's stolen. Here comes Harden over Williams.
He's showing Harden two nice moves now, right to the rim. Is it going to be too little too late for LSU? You know, they've tried to throw this pressure defense at USF, but this is what they've been able to do is, you know, break through it and get easy baskets, easy looks. And not only that, able to get to the free throw line. 27 times today. The Bulls have been to the free throw line, knocked down 20 of them.
And they get there again. Deamer fouls Williams. Among her other virtues, Williams a very good free throw shooter. 77%, eighth best in the league. This is a very important night in the history of the basketball program at USF, getting to host an NCAA tournament game for the first time. Jose Fernandez says it's a great opportunity for our program and for our university to get recognition. And then you add to that, Brooke, that in just 2 weeks, the women's Final Four will be right here in Tampa, not in this arena, at the Amalie Arena. And it will be the second time that Tampa and the University of South Florida have hosted a women's Final Four. Peterson drives. Looked like Ferreira was lying on the baseline and she touched the ball, so it will go back to LSU. Weber departs. Jesperson back in. Jesperson, how about this, Brooke? Numbers off the bench for Jesperson. 11 points, 5 for 5 from the floor, 5 rebounds, and 2 block shots.
From a freshman. You're getting that kind of production, not only from her, but Ferreira with those two huge threes to start off this second half. We've seen some terrific performances by freshmen today, haven't we?
Aisha Hines-Allen had 19 for Louisville in the first game. Louisville has another terrific freshman in Mariah Moore. Second team All-ACC in her first year with the Cards, who will be here on Monday. Williams with the pull-up. Rebound pulled down by Ballard with a minute and a half remaining. So it will be a couple of old friends getting together here on Monday night. Former Big East brethren, former American Athletic Conference brethren, USF and Louisville as Ballard hits the jumper. Jeff Walls and Jose Fernandez are very good friends.
Yeah, I doubt we'll see quite the same physical game that we saw with Louisville and BYU. But you are going to see some great talent, some young talent. And it's a game that, you know, depending on how it's played defensively, a little bit loves to try and turn you over. USF the same thing, but sometimes you get those two teams together, knock down a couple of shots, and we could be looking at an 80-90 point game depending on how it goes. But one thing's for sure, those two coaches know each other very, very well, long history, so you know everything will be pretty much scouted ahead of time.
Ferreira has a little cut on her leg, so we'll have to quickly bandage that so she can continue playing. Boy, those trainers are lightning quick, aren't they?
Yeah, because, you know, back in the day when you got blood anywhere, boy, you were, like, out for 10 minutes. So they tried to figure out what was going on. Oh, you can't come back to the game.
That took 10 seconds.
That's right. It's efficiency.
Shot clock inside 10, and the fans begin chanting USF. Jose Fernandez winds up with the ball, but he doesn't have any eligibility left. Cuban-American, born in Miami, educated at Florida International University. He was an assistant men's coach at Barry College, a junior college. He was the girls' basketball coach at Lourdes Academy, then an assistant coach at Barry College. Then he got the head coaching job here at USF in 2000. He's in his 15th year. This will be his 261st win, most in school history, third NCAA appearance. They've completely renovated this arena. They practically gutted it. They lost use of it for a year while they did that. They had to play their games elsewhere. They have this magnificent practice center adjacent to this arena, the Muma Center. So they have wonderful facilities, and the future is very bright for USF.
And look at that shot that Rena Hill took. And she is limping off this floor, but she took all kinds of contact and not even able to stay in to finish her free throws. And that's a tough player for Rena Hill to have to be carried, pretty much carried her own self off the floor. But right now, you know, you really see doubled over in paint.
Young lady from Nagoya-shi, Japan, who played 1 year here in Florida at IMG Academy. Yeah. One of her teammates, Regine Moncrief, is from Fort Lauderdale. She has lots of family and friends here tonight. Final minute. LSU trapping the ball, and they get a held ball. And on the arrow, it will go back to the Lady Tigers. So what are you looking for on Monday night between Louisville and LSU? You have lots of athleticism, certainly Louisville, from just the physical stature and strength, would have the advantage because of the sheer size of Hines, Allen, and Moore. But then you got the athletes for Williams, like Williams and Jenkins.
Yeah, and it'll be an interesting blend of styles, because you've got five scorers on the floor right now for USF. Nikki Caldwell going to give a hug to her players who have put in a tough effort today. Deshaun Harden, very upset with herself right now. It's a hard moment to realize that your season is over. The tears flow, but Nikki Caldwell trying to pump her up, saying, hey, you did what you could to get us here, senior. We enjoyed having you for my program.
LSU won't quit. They get the steal, and Deamer gets the layup. All of a sudden, the lead is single digit. LSU is going to call a timeout for the sole purpose of getting a substitute. And the clock will keep running as Ann Peterson departs. She has another year of eligibility. And then the inbound pass. Williams will dribble across, and now LSU will call off the dogs. So on the night that USF hosts an NCAA tournament game for the first time in its history, the Bulls get the win, and they advance to the second round for the second time. And they will have a date with the Louisville Cardinals, a school that they...